Friends, in today's lecture, we shall be discussing a very important subject of law which relates to the concept, origin, application and judicial decisions with regard to the preemption as it is applicable in the country. Preemption as such is a very important subject for a student of personal law, and let's first see how this preemption started in this country, what's its origin, what's its definition, how it's applied in various communities, among the Muslims, among the Hindus, among the other communities, and then what is the judicial attitude towards the application of the preemption law. Now friends, firstly we must have an idea what is preemption. Preemption means first option to buy. It is a preferential legal right of buying a thing before all others. Under the Muslim law, it's called as shufa. It's a right to repurchase an adjacent immovable property which has been sold to someone else by paying a sum equal to the purchase price. Under this right, the owner of an immovable property is entitled to compel the purchaser of his adjacent property to resell it to him for the same price which was paid by him, that's by the purchaser to the seller who has already sold the property to the purchaser. The person who is entitled to claim this right is called a preemptor or shufi. The things required for the application of this right are: 1. The preemptor should be the owner of immovable property. 2. There must be a sale of certain immovable property adjacent to the immovable property. That is, the property which has been sold should be close to the person who claims the right of preemption. The third thing is that preemptor must be in some relationship with the seller of the property. For example, a co-heirer, co-sharer or a neighbor. Then the fourth essential thing for executing a preemption is certain formalities are to be fulfilled, which we shall be discussing in the later stage of our discussion. The basic idea behind this kind of preferential right is to avoid the introduction of a stranger into the adjoining land, so the co-heirers, neighbors or co-sharers have been given a right to have an offer of sale of the nearby land whenever the owner of the property wants to sell it. That means if A wants to sell the property, he has to ask his neighbor, he has to ask his co-sharer, he has to ask his co-heirer whether he wants to purchase this land which he is intended to sell or not. When he refuses, then he can go to the other purchaser who is intending to purchase that land or that property. What is the origin of this right to preemption? Where from it originated? In India, the law of preemption prevailed in various parts of the country on the basis of different sources like Muslim personal law, customs among village communities, statutes passed by the legislature from time to time, and contractual preemption, etc. The judiciary has tried to describe the origin of the right of preemption in Digambar Singh versus Ahmed, AIR 1914, PC, that's Privy Council 14 case. The Privy Council observed, preemption in village communities in British India had its origin in the Muslim personal law and was apparently unknown to India before the time of the Mughal rulers. In the course of the time, custom of preemption grew up or were adapted among village communities. In some cases, the sharers in a village adopted or followed the rules of Muslim personal law of preemption. In other cases, where a custom of preemption exists, each village community has a custom of preemption which varies from the Muslim personal law of preemption and is peculiar to a village in its provisions and its incidents. A custom of preemption was doubtless in all cases the result of agreement among the shareholders of the particular village and may have been adopted in modern times and in villages which were first constituted in modern times. Rights of preemption have in some states been created by contract between the sharers in a village, but in all cases the object is as far as possible to prevent strangers to a village from becoming sharers in the village. That means the basic object is that no stranger should come into the village, acquire the property, and it is better if the property remains within the what we call as within the rights of the persons who are the inhabitants of that particular village. Rights of preemption, when they exist, are valuable rights, and when they depend upon a custom or upon a contract, the custom or the contract, as the case may be, must, if disputed, be proved. That is, it is to be proved that there is a custom that this right of preemption should be there. Now, what are the various sources wherefrom we get this concept of preemption or what you call as law of Shifa? Now, the first source is the Muslim personal law, and it's the main source of right to preemption. Law of preemption in India is based upon the text of Islamic law. The law becomes operational as a rule of common law of the land in the areas which came under the Mughal regime. The origin of this right may be traced from the texts of the Islamic law and particularly from the number of traditions of Prophet as given in Hidayah. These are: a neighbor has a right superior to that of a stranger in the lands adjacent to his own. The right of Shifa holds in a partner who has not divided off and taken separately his share. The crux of these traditions is that when the owner of property intends to sell it, he must offer it to the preemptors first. But nowadays, this rule is applicable to all the Muslim claims claimed on the basis of local customs. That is, local customs have also played a very important role in this regard. Then the second source of the preemption right is the customs. The law of preemption is based on the customs in some parts of the India. No doubt this doctrine was the part of the Muslim personal law, but other communities also starts to apply it on the basis of the customs and usages. Therefore, the law of preemption was adapted by the Hindus because it was complementary to their notion of joint family. That is why the Hindus adopted it, because they feel that it is just like the Hindu family where they bought this property is not divided as such. It is applicable to the Hindus of Bihar, Sylhet, certain parts of Gujarat like Surat, Bharuch, Godhra, Ahmedabad, Delhi and Marabar, etc. Then, besides these two sources, there are some special enactments which has been passed by the state from time to time, and they legalize the custom of preemption. In some states of the India, the rule of the preemption is applicable to Muslims as well as non-Muslims. Acts regulating the law of the preemption are Punjab Preemption Act 1913 as amended in 1960 and applicable to Haryana and part of Delhi, B. Agra Preemption Act 1922 and the Awadh Laws Act 1876 applicable in Uttar Pradesh, Bhopal Preemption Act 1934 and the Rewa State Preemption Act 1948 enforceable in Madhya Pradesh, and Rajasthan Preemption Act 1966. In these states, the rule of preemption is regulated by these acts. Even the Muslims of these territories are subject to these statutory laws and they cannot claim the right under personal laws. That is, their personal law is overruled by these acts so far as the preemption is concerned. Then third way by which this right to preemption can be created is the contract amongst the parties. When the village community amongst themselves enter into the contract that we adapt this preemption right, that is also valid and legal. Apart from any customary or statutory law, the same right may be created through a contract. Any two persons, either Muslims or non-Muslims, may enter into the contract for the application of the law of preemption to them. The terms and conditions of this contract need not to be in accordance with the Muslim personal law. That is, they can themselves make their own conditions or their own, what we call as their own rules regarding to that particular law. In a village community, the co-sharers may create the right of preemption through contract. Justice Mahmood, in one of the famous cases decided by the Allahabad High Court, has defined preemption as, under, I quote, a right which the owner of certain immovable property possesses as such for the quiet enjoyment of that immovable property to obtain in substitution for the buyer preparatory possession of certain other immovable property not his own on such terms and those on which such later immovable property is sold to another person, unquote. In Govind Dayal versus Anayatullah 1885-7 Allahabad 779 case, term preemption is defined as a right which the owner of immovable property possesses as such for the quiet enjoyment of that immovable property to obtain in substitution for the buyer proprietary possession of certain other immovable property not his own on such terms as those on which such later immovable property is sold to another person, unquote. Following are the essential requisites of preemption. 1. Preemption is a preferential right possessed by the owner of an immovable property to purchase an adjacent immovable property when it offers to someone else by its owner. 2. The preemptor has the right to substitute the buyer by paying the same price which was paid by him, that is buyer, to the original owner of the property. It is right of substitution but not of repurchase. C. The basis of this right is to ensure the quiet enjoyment of the property. Now, classification of preemptors. The right to preemption is available to three classes of persons under the Muslim law, which are as under. The co-sharers are Shifai Sharik or co-owners. The co-sharers are the persons entitled to succeed to the property of a common ancestor. This class has a preferential right of preemption over the other two because of their blood relationship. The participators in immunities are Shifai Kelth. This class consists of those persons who enjoy a common privilege like a common right of way or right to discharge water or any other common right to use a property. These persons are called as participators in immunities and appendages. Following persons may claim right of preemption as Shifai Kedlit, owner of a dominant heritage or owner of a servient heritage. This right cannot be claimed on the basis of easement of light or air, the right to draw water from a government water course or the branches of his tree project over the land of a neighbor or the right to use village roads, canals, etc. The neighbor or owner of adjoining properties of Shafai Jar. The neighbor or owner of the adjacent properties can be a preemptor as Shafai Jar. The person claiming this right must be the owner of the property and not mere tenant or person having the possession of the property only. The right of this category is restricted only to the houses, gardens and small pieces of land, but the right of vicinage has been declared unconstitutional by the Supreme Court. The preemptors of first class are preferred over the second class and the second class is preferred over the third one. Only in absence of any claimant from first category, the premier from second class may exercise his right, and in absence of second category, the right of third category arises where more than one person is claiming the right of preemption as member of same class. They have right in equal proportion. The property would be divided equally among them, even if their shares are unequal. What can be the subject matter of preemption? That is, okay, what type of property can be the subject matter of preemption? Subject matter of preemption means the properties which may be claimed by the preemptor. Following types of properties may be the subject matter of preemption: A, immovable properties including houses, gardens, small piece of land, well, canal, etc., both divisible or indivisible. Immovable properties may be the subject matter of preemption. B, things permanently attached to the earth like trees, houses. If these things are sold along with the land, then it is the subject matter of preemption. But if they are sold after separating it from the immovable property, it is not shufa. C, movable property can be the subject matter of preemption so long as it is a part of a thing which is attached to the land, that is the standing crops in the fields. If the crops are sold along with the field, then it is the subject matter of preemption. Preemption must be claimed regarding whole property and not a part only. There is one exception to this rule, that is, several properties are sold by the same contract, including the properties which are not the subject matter of preemption. Then the preemptor has a right to claim only those properties which amount to shufa. Now, what are the formalities which one has to complete before the completion of preemption right? For the exercise of the right of preemption, some formalities are required to be observed. In case of incomplete or erroneous formalities, the right of preemption does not take place. The preemptor has to follow the proper formalities at the proper time. These formalities are also denoted as three demands, which are: the first demand of talabi mawasibat, or immediate demand. Talabi mawasibat means demand of jumping or immediate demand. It means the first demand should be made immediately on hearing of the sale, but not before. No witness is required to make the first demand. There is no particular form or words to make talabi mawasibat. The only thing required is that the first demand must be made after the completion of the sale. The second demand or talabi ishad, or confirmatory demand. Second demand, which is also called talabi takrir, means demand of confirmation. The second demand, being the repetition of the first demand, is called as confirmatory demand. There is no particular form to make second demand, but it must fulfill the following requirements. That is, no, it's not necessary that what words you should use, what type of action you should do, but certain requirements are there which must be completed. The one is, that is, A, the preemptor must mention his first demand and should affirm his intention to exercise his right of making second demand. B, second demand must be made in the presence of at least two witnesses. C, second demand must be addressed to the seller or the buyer of the property which is the subject matter of sale. If there are more than one buyers, then in presence of all of them, that is, the demand must be paid in presence of all the buyers. D, property over which the right is claimed must be clearly described, and E, it should be made as soon as possible after the first demand. The third demand of talabe tamlik, or demand for possession. Third demand is a legal action taken by the preemptor for possession of the property claimed by him in first and second demands. The preemptor enforces his right by bringing a suit when his claim is not allowed. That is, he has to go to the court of law, file a suit. The suit or claim must be for entire property or interest. The preemptor may make the first and second demand at the same time. While making first demand, the preemptor may bring the witnesses in the presence of the seller or purchaser or on the property which is to be sold. then the second demand may be made immediately following the first at the same time. Now, what are the effects of preemption? When the preemption is granted, when the preemption is given, what are its effects? When the right of preemption is claimed and it is being enforced, the preemptor is substituted in the place of buyer. That is, now he becomes the preemptor, becomes the buyer. He takes the property from the buyer by paying equivalent amount of price paid by the buyer to the seller. Following are the effects of the preemption. Number one, right of preemptor to take possession of the property. The preemptor may take possession of the property by paying purchase money to the buyer. Then after taking the possession of the property, the preemptor is substituted for the purchaser. The buyer becomes seller and the preemptor becomes the buyer. Number two, purchaser's right to means profits. The purchaser of the property who gets substituted by the preemptor is entitled to means profits. He can claim these profits between the first sale and subsequent transfer to the preemptor. When the possession is taken by the preemptor, then he becomes entitled to receive all the benefits, that is rents and other things. Number three, destruction of the property. The preemptor is entitled to reduction in price of the property if it is destructed after the first sale. This reduction of price may be claimed only if the destruction is caused due to any of the following reasons. One, purchaser's fault. B, destruction by natural calamity, that is like earthquakes, floods, etc. No liability of preemptor to pay increased price after the first sale. 5. The period of limitation for filing a suit for preemption is given under Article 97 of the Schedule of Limitation Act 1963. It prescribes the period of 1 year to file suit for preemption, otherwise the right cannot be exercised. Preemption among Hindus. How this law of preemption is applicable to the Hindus? The right of preemption is also applicable to Hindus in the following circumstances. 1. Custom. The Muslim law of preemption was started to be recognized by the Hindus by custom. By statutes, the right of preemption is also applicable to the Hindus by some special state acts, which we have already discussed in our discussion. By contract, along with the customary and statutory rights, the right of preemption may also be created by mutual contract between the parties. Any two persons may be agreed upon to have a preferential right to purchase the share of the other. This also we have already discussed in our discussion. Now the question is, what is difference between Sunni and Shia law of Muslims and Hindus on preemption? Now Sunni law recognizes the co-sharers, the participators in the immunities or appendages and the owners of the adjoining land as preemptors. Shia law recognizes only the co-sharers as the class of preemptor. Co-emptor, co-sharer too can claim this right where their number does not exceed 2. No one of them can preempt if they are more than 2. Similarly, under the Hindu Succession Act 1956, only class 1 heirs are entitled to claim the preemption. Right to sue. As per Sunni law, the right to sue for preemption is a personal right which extinguishes if the preemptor dies before obtaining a degree in the suit. Whereas under Shia law, the suit may be continued by the heirs of the preemptor as the right is not extinguished. Under the Hindu law, the right of co-heirs to seek transfer of property proposed to be sold is only a personal right which is neither transferable nor heritable. Now let us discuss in brief the constitutional validity of the right of preemption. Article 19(5) also provides a room for some reasonable restrictions which may be imposed on the right of a person under Article 19, Clause 1, Subclause F. In Atma Prakash v. State of Haryana, AIR 1986, Supreme Court 859, Supreme Court held that right of preemption on the ground of consanguinity, that is, on the ground that preemptor is a co-sharer of the seller, is constitutionally invalid. The court was of the view that this right was exercised for the preservation of the unity of the family and integrity of the society. Now, these reasons are totally irrelevant. Later on, the Supreme Court of India took a contrary view in Krishna v. State of Haryana, AR 1994, Supreme Court 2536, where the court held the right of preemption on the ground of consanguinity is not violative of Article 14, 15 and 16 of the Constitution. Similarly, in Razak Sajjan Sahab Bhagwan and others versus Ibrahim Hazi Muhammad Hussain, AIR 1999, Supreme Court 2043 case, the Supreme Court has also declared the right of preemption on the ground of neighborhood to be unconstitutional. Now friends, I hope that you have been benefited by this today's discussion, which we had on a very important topic, that is the preemption and its application in the country, how it is applied, what is the legal validity of the preemption. And if you have any questions, you can put it, and then you can find the answers in the discussions which we had today with you. Thank you very much.